Hi, so my name is Adebayo Oke Lawal, as you can see, and I own the brand called Orange Culture. So yeah, I will be telling you how I use fashion as a tool for social economic change. And who am I? My name is Adebayo, as I said. I'm from Lagos, Nigeria. I'm a fashion designer, and I've been designing for 12 years now. So I launched my brand in 2010, and I launched it in Lagos. I knew that I wanted to have a fashion brand ever since I was a kid. But you know, having a fashion brand isn't enough. And I think for a lot of us then, it was just, oh, I just want to make shirts, I just want to make trousers. But for me, I wanted a brand that had not just clothes, but actually had a story to tell and actually had something that was passionate or something that we wanted to communicate to the world. And that's how I started my brand called Orange Culture. Orange Culture, why? Why not just Adebayo Oke Lawal? Why not a self-named brand? But when I was 16, I wrote an article called The Orange Boy. And I remember because I was sitting in this writing class and they were asking us about colors. And everyone was like, oh, you know, I'm going to write about blue, about red, about green, all these colors that I mean. Boys picking blue, boys picking green, girls picking pink, girls picking yellow. You know the typical thing, you know, it's the stereotypical colors that you pick when you're assigned a gender. And I was like, oh, you know, I'm going to write about this color called orange. And I wrote an article called The Orange Boy, which was basically about navigating gender when you don't fit into the stereotype of gender. Because I was a boy who lived in Lagos, which, you know, has been groomed to have a misogynistic view of how men are supposed to portray themselves. And I didn't necessarily fit into that view. I mean, look at me here, I have feathers on my sleeves, and I'm wearing boots with how many inches, you know, of heels. So I mean, I didn't really fit into what people expected a man to look like or a man to sound like. And so I wanted to write an article that basically expressed my interactions with the world as this boy who would go to school and would be bullied for sounding a bit lighter or would be bullied for drawing, you know, clothes behind his school books and whatnot. And so I wrote this article called Orange Boy, which was basically about my life and being bullied and being told that I cannot do all the things I wanted to do. Fashion was not for men, and sounding like me was going to basically weaken my opportunities in the world. So Orange Boy was basically a representation of everyone who felt like an outlier, everyone who felt like they didn't fit in. And orange for me was the color that I felt wasn't blue, wasn't green. It wasn't a typical color. It wasn't a color everyone called or everybody wanted. But when you look closer, it's actually really beautiful. And it's actually such a special color, but it's not really a color that's assigned to any gender when you think about it. And so Orange Boy represented that individuality, that specialness, that uniqueness, and a space for everyone to feel like they could belong, in a sense. So why do I create, and what is my motivation to create? So I live in Nigeria, as most of you know. Nigeria is such a beautiful country, such a wonderful country, but we do have a lot of stereotypes that we fall under. And not just Nigeria, lots of people fall under these stereotypes. I mean, stereotypes when it comes to gender, like I said. You know, I grew up being told all the time that men were supposed to act in very, very specific ways. And for me, not being aligned to those specificities, like being necessarily the most hard or the most masculine, I wanted to kind of use my brand to have conversations around why those sort of masculine stereotypes were actually detrimental and toxic. And you know, it made me realize that a lot of men literally had issues with emotional communication and emotional interaction with not just, you know, other men, but with even their families, with their kids, and with people that they loved, but they couldn't just communicate how much they love them. And those things, in, for example, in Nigeria, the rate of suicide is higher amongst men. Why? Because a lot of men have kept and bottled up their emotions and feel the need to, oh, act hard, because they've been told by so many people that, oh, when you cry, it's weak. When you emote, it's weak. And those things, those stereotypes around how men are supposed to act have actually been very detrimental to a lot of men's mental and emotional health. And so I wanted my brand to sort of elevate that conversation, because when I started, menswear especially was very much stereotypical. Suits, GQ, that's it, nothing else. And I started a brand in 2010 and I had skirts and I had men in color. I remember I had a suit that was red and everybody was like, oh my God, a man in a red suit, you're going to hell. You know, it was like this crazy idea. Why should a man wear color? Why should a man wear pink? Why should a man wear all these things? And you know, I felt like that conversation needed to be had, because people were not discussing it and men were going through all sorts of emotional issues because they weren't having those conversations. So that's one of the things that I constantly elevate with my brand. Toxic masculinity, as I've elevated, guys, it's literally just men thinking that their whole entirety, their whole, you know, being is assigned to this idea of how a man is supposed to act. Men, you can cry. Women, men are not weak for crying. Everyone needs to understand that. Politically, I live in a country that's politically problematic in every way. we have one of the most corrupt leaderships in the world, one of the most corrupt financial systems in the world. And, you know, I feel like as a business or as a fashion brand, part of your job is to challenge the society and speak on things that matter to you and matter to your community. And for me, last year was a really big year for us because we had one of the most political protests that we've ever had in the country. And it was called the NSAS protest. I don't know if anybody here has heard about this. And basically, we have an issue with police brutality back home. And I felt like it's part of my job as a brand to use my platform to elevate this conversation. And we had a huge protest which led to deaths of numbers of people. And the government tried to continually silence this conversation because they told us it didn't really happen. It was just CGI. It was just technology. Nobody really died. And a part of a brand's job for any fashion designer here is to care for your community and to have conversations around the health of your community. So one of the things that I always make sure that I do is to elevate conversations that have to do with where I come from. And not just the good, because yes, we can talk about the good. We can say we're beautiful, we're this, we're that, but how do we make change with our platforms if we don't talk about the bad as well? So I use my platform to also have conversations around what our government is doing. It's been problematic sometimes. They threaten, they do all of those things, but you do have to continue to have those conversations around what is happening in your community and what you can do to help make change. You know, for a country like mine, where I come from, I always say that the media has done a really bad job on how Nigeria is represented all over the world. Everywhere in the world has their own version of what is going on that's wrong. But for some reason, the media continues to project that Nigeria is one of the most unsafe places, one of the most problematic places. Yes, we have our issues, but just like any other country, there are places that are safe and there are places that are not. And I remember even as a fashion designer, one of my biggest issues starting a business that wanted to retail, every time I would go out, people would say, oh, you're producing in Nigeria. Sorry, we can't work with you. Because they've been told, even though they've never experienced it, oh, the quality will be bad for sure. The people are not, they're not trustworthy. The this, the that, because the media has propagated this version of what Nigeria has been. And part of my job is to portray Nigeria in a positive light. It's to say that even though, yes, we have these issues, as I can highlight many of your issues, we also have many positives. I mean, this outfit I'm wearing is Nigerian, you know? It's made by hands in Nigeria. And everything I've worn here has been made by hands in Nigeria. And so we can produce beautiful work. We can do amazing things. So part of my work is to change the narrative as to how we are perceived by the world, how we're perceived by all of you now. You can go back to your families and say, oh, I met a Nigerian and he wore a nice suit. Yeah, you know, they make nice clothes. And, you know, it's not about malaria all the time. It's not about monkeypox. You know, they do beautiful things and they have joy. They have happiness. They're lovely people. So part of my job as a brand is to propagate a positive narrative, like Yaki Kenna is doing as well, about Nigeria and about where we come from as well. Yes, so how does fashion contribute to social change? You know, I always tell people, I hate when people tell me, especially it happens in Nigeria, oh, you know, you're not a doctor, you're not a scientist, you can't save lives. I always say fashion can save lives because just like any other job, fashion has a part to play in how, you know, the world is perceived, how, you know, the environment changes. Fashion has a huge part to play. So how can fashion save lives and what are we doing to help with that? So part of the things that a fashion designer should be thinking about is how your clothes are being made. Unlike a lot of environments where, you know, you guys, I'm not saying you, but I mean generally, a lot of people work with factories that they don't even know how the children or how the people who are working are kept, whether they're living in nice homes, whether the conditions for production are done properly. They don't even care because they're working with manufacturing companies who just give them what they want. We, on the other hand, in Nigeria, work with a slow fashion method. We've always worked with slow fashion, and we believe that you should know your tailors. You should know what they're doing, where they live, where they come from. Where your clothes come from is just as important as the clothes that you're wearing. who is making the clothes is just as important as the clothes that you're wearing. So part of my job is to know my tailors. I know all my tailors by name. If they see me on the road, they know that that's the person whose clothes we're making. They know, I know where they live. I know their families because it's important. Guys, you can't make clothes and not care about the people that are making your clothes. You can't make clothes and not care about whether their backs are hurting them every time they're making your clothes. It's the worst. So I'm honestly a pusher for slow fashion. Even the way we work, we do even our e-com systems, we believe in made to order. We will make it as per order because we don't want to have fabrics wasting. We don't want to have clothes sitting in a room and dumped somewhere and, you know, used, you know, for also dumped in the ocean or dumped. We want to create clothes that are going to a specific person. And we've created systems that also help with that as well. We have a system where you can return your clothes to the brand and you can say, oh, you know, I have these jeans. They're not looking that great. You can bring your jeans back and we'll change it up for you and make it look new. And, you know, I think for fashion designers, we always have to think about our community. We believe in a supply chain that's local. We've always believed in a supply chain that's local. I remember when I started designing, people would tell me all the time, oh, go produce in China. Why are you producing in Nigeria? Why are you producing in Africa? Go to China, go to Turkey. And I was like, you know, if I keep going to China, keep going to Turkey, then how do we get better? How does the production system grow? How do we give back to the community? How are people getting jobs? You know, we have to find ways to give to our community, to give back to, and to help our communities develop. So one of the things that we focus on is local supply chains. We make sure that we produce locally. We try to source all our fabrics locally. We try to support, for example, our cottons are woven in Nigeria, all those things just to help make sure that the money isn't just going out, but it's actually coming back in as well. So try to find ways to support your community, whether it's through production, through manufacturing, and also through community development. We have a program called Orange Mentorship, which allows people who don't have an education in fashion to still get access to knowledge. And what we do is we bring designers from all over the country and the continent to speak to young people who cannot go to fashion school, who cannot afford to go to CSM or go to London College of Fashion, and we get them the access to knowledge. Because a lot of us back home don't go to fashion school. There's no fashion schools in Nigeria that are accredited. So how do we learn? You give them access to knowledge. You give them people that they can talk to who have experience. And one of the things we do is ensure that people have that access. So we give them knowledge transfer opportunities as well. We collaborate. And I think that's something that if you're interested in working with Africans in any form, because I know a lot of people here might be like, oh, I want to work with the African community, the fashion design community. How do I go about it? Collaborate, not appropriate. Collaborate. They're two very different things. Work with the people. Work with the talent, work with the skill. Don't come, take, and come back to your country and say, oh, I got this out from Africa, I can make 1,000 in my factory. And now say, oh, it's, you know, it's a design from us. We made it, we originated it. That's called appropriation, my darling. So collaborate, work with people, work with writers, work with photographers, work with designers, work with NGOs, work with foundations, work with everyone rather than just appropriating. You know, people say, why is gender such an important conversation for the brand like mine? I always say that, for me, gender, the idea of gender, a lot when I was growing up, was a stifling conversation because it always made me feel like an outlier. It always made me feel like, oh, I didn't belong, or I didn't fit in. And so it's important for us to have conversations around that so that we can help people understand why these stereotypes are very detrimental. And not just from now, but with your kids, with your children. It's very important that people grow up with this idea, knowing that people should be liberated to live and express themselves freely, emotionally, mentally, spiritually. Allow everyone the diversity and the freedom to be as they choose, rather than forcing them into a box. And that's why I have these conversations and these colors and these different expressions of masculinity, because I do not believe that there's one assigned version of masculinity that everyone should have. Everyone should be free to live and choose as they want to and express their gender or not belief in gender as they choose. Please, if you want to work with us, collaborate, speak to us, engage us, and I speak to me, speak to Nigeria, and speak, rather than just accepting what the media has told you, speak to us, engage us, understand where we're coming from, understand where we're going and what we're trying to do. And the fashion industry and the creative industry in Nigeria is doing such an amazing job and is doing such a great space to actually elevate the economy, elevate the perception of fashion in Nigeria, and especially exception of Nigerians as a whole. So please work with us, collaborate with us, and learn from us as well. So thank you very much. Come find us here. That was a lot of growth. Thank you.
Very good.
Thank you so much.
Adebayo, you were worried about not being able to fill the time.
I know, I noticed. That's why I just shortened it quickly. I'm okay. So sorry, everyone, but yeah.
Let me jump right in. You clearly see yourself as someone who wants to speak truth to power. Mm. You are robust in what you say. Do you find that kind of like that activism empowering? Or when it comes to your creativity, is that also limiting?
I find it more empowering than limiting. I mean, I literally only have one life, so I don't really allow anyone really limit my expression or whatnot, because I find it empowering because I've seen what it can do. I've seen how lives have been changed just by the kind of conversations that we have, and how perceptions can be changed by the kind of conversations that we have. I've seen people who maybe believed one thing before, and just by a conversation or by a portrayal, by a film or a show or a press release, things can switch. So I think that the way that we can get people to kind of change, you know, their ideologies, because ideologies are very detrimental sometimes when they're, you know, far right, for example. Yeah. I think that that can really help. And so I think that you empower yourself and you empower people by having those conversations, being an activist.
So being purpose-driven is really, really important. Okay, you mentioned as well, people need to, if they want to work with you, they need to come and collaborate, mm-hmm. have a conversation, mm-hmm. and understand where you're going, mm-hmm. where we're going. Mm-hmm. There's a saying in Nigeria, Naija no de kari last.
Yeah,
we're always leading the way, trying to lead the way. So tell us, where is Nigerian fashion going?
I think Nigerian fashion is going, getting to a place where we're growing from within and where we're looking to work with people, because for many years, our voices have been taken from us and, you know, the gaze has been put on us as to what we're supposed to be. But finally, we're taking up the space and saying, this is who we are. This is the resources we have. We're using it ourselves. We're not allowing people to take our textiles anymore and say it's theirs. We're not allowing people to take our designs anymore and say it's theirs. We're having the conversations ourselves and we're owning our voice. And I think there's power in a lot of that.
Yeah, for sure. Mm. You have to, oh no, oh, what a shame. But you're still around for the whole day.
Yeah.
Oh. Exactly.
Thank you so much.
Well,
thank
you can have more, of course, because Adebayo is also at the breakout session on gender, design, and power. So be sure to hit up that session. And
thank you so much.
Thank you
very much. Everyone.
Bye.
Thank you.
Yeah.
This is how we do it.
This is how we do it.